My name is James Robson, and I'm the Victor and William Fung Director of the Harvard Asia Center. I'd like to welcome you to the Asia Center's Research Talk Series, which is part of a new series of virtual programming at the Asia Center. The research talks are aimed at showcasing some of the fascinating research that's being done on various facets of Asia by Harvard students, graduate students, faculty, Asia Center affiliates, and other specialists. We very much hope you enjoyed learning from these talks.
Hello, my name is Adhira Mangalagiri. I'm a lecturer in the Department of Comparative Literature at Queen Mary University of London, and I'm also an associate at the Harvard University Asia Center. My talk today is entitled Friction as China-India Literary Relation. We hear a lot about friction between China and India in the media and in popular discourse, and especially today, given the border clashes that took place earlier this year in June 2020. We've come to associate the concept of friction with political relations and military conflict between nation states, the deterioration of bilateral political relations. My talk today discusses how we might reclaim the idea of friction from the discourse of international relations and put it instead to humanistic use. How can we reconceive of the idea of friction as a uniquely literary form of relation, and not as eroding transnational ties, but as making possible new ways to relate literarily across national borders? The contemporary usage of friction as denoting the rise of tensions between nation states finds roots in friction's physical properties, as the energy or heat generated during the chafing of surfaces in motion, a phenomenon necessary for sustaining motion, even as it resists or slows motion down. As such, friction carries an affective dimension, a surging, a rubbing, bodies literally affecting one another and generating intensities, in Kathleen Stewart's words. As a literary concept, I want to offer a reconceptualization of friction as positioned at the intersection of two somewhat contradictory threads of meaning. At once a distancing or severing of connection, the antagonistic clash, and at the same time, the close intimacy of a fraught encounter, the uncomfortable chafing. At once destructive of one order, yet generative of new intensities emitted during the clash. Reading friction literarily entails capturing and giving shape to the literary creative energy sparked when antagonists rub up against each other, each resisting the other at the same time as the two remain bound together in conflict. So, how can we use this literary idea of friction to read novels, short stories, and poetry in new, productive ways? I'll turn now to a largely forgotten archive of Chinese literary texts that engage with ideas of India. The texts appear on the surface to voice expressions of antagonism toward Indian figures. And yet, I'll show how harnessing the productive potential of friction can make possible new readings of these texts. By the late 19th century, British rule in China and India had produced a strange, unprecedented set of circumstances wherein Chinese and Indians began to encounter each other from opposing sides of the colonizer-colonized divide. In Shanghai's international settlement, for example, the Indian members of the Shanghai Municipal Police soon became an entrenched feature of everyday life on the streets of Shanghai. These Indian policemen functioned as a stark visual reminder of foreign presence in China. Chinese residents viewed these men as ferocious, with dark, hairy faces, and as the abhorrent executors of colonial power and violence. But the Indian policeman was also regarded as silent and passive, a colonized slave, or Wang Guonu in Chinese. Thus, in Shanghai's international settlement, the face of the colonizer often donned an Indian mask. The caption to this photograph emphasizes the ubiquity of the Indian policeman in Shanghai. It states that the Indian policeman was visible at the corner of every junction, and although he came from a colonized nation, in his view, the Chinese citizens were even more lowly than himself. The Indian policeman's daily presence on the streets of Shanghai gave rise to an outpouring of literary texts published mostly in Shanghai's journals and newspapers, from jokes, sketches, and poetry to short stories and lengthy serialized novels, all depicting the Indian policeman as a literary figure. At first glance, these texts seem to primarily convey hostility and hatred toward the Indian policeman. However, reading these texts as literary friction reveals much, much more. Friction in these texts puts into motion a particular form of fraught China-India intimacy and generates productive and transformative literary energies. These literary energies emitted at the moment of clash with the Indian policeman make possible new understandings of China's anti-colonial discourse of the early 20th century and reshape the well-known literary debates of the May 4th era. I'll now discuss two such texts. The first is a novel titled Shuang Ling Hun, Twin Souls, by an enigmatic writer who went by the pen name Ya Tong Po Fo. The novel was serially published in the newspaper Shenbao in 1907. Twin Souls is set in Shanghai and tells the story of a man whose body contains within it two souls, one Chinese and one Indian. As the novel begins, a Chinese student, Huang Zuhan, stumbles upon an Indian policeman, Jing Arya, and as the two bodies literally bump into each other, Arya's soul accidentally transfers into Zuhan's body. The novel tells the story of this Chinese body that contains within it two souls, one Chinese and one Indian, each vying for control over the body. When the Indian's soul is in control, the man acts as though he is an Indian policeman, even speaking in English and what is termed an Indian language. And when the Chinese soul manages to gain back control of the body, the man resumes his life as a Chinese student. The novel is full of humorous scenes, but it also evokes a darker allegorical reading of a nation invaded by foreign powers fighting to regain autonomy. There are many expressions in the novel of hatred towards the Indian policeman as an unwanted invader. But we also see during the moments when the Indian soul has taken over the body, the remarkable sight of a Chinese body experiencing firsthand and on a bodily register, the abuse and oppression that the Indian policeman receives at the hands of the British colonizer. At these moments, the Chinese body shares in the Indian's experience of colonization, and the reader begins to view the Indian policeman not only as an unwanted colonizing presence, but also as a fellow colonized being oppressed by the same Western colonizer. See, for example, this scene that takes place when the twin-souled man is taken to the police station in the international settlement and is thrown into a prison cell by another Indian prison guard. From within the cell, the twin-souled man, currently under the control of the Indian soul, calls out to this Indian prison guard in an Indian language. He exclaims, "We have lost our nation and our people have been stamped out. We are compatriots. How can you not feel any camaraderie towards me? How can you still imprison me?" Remember, these are the words of a man who appears and who is recognized by those around him as Chinese. At this point, a British inspector overhears this interaction, rushes over, and starts beating the twin-souled man. The narrative explains that whenever Indian policemen are heard talking in their own language, they're immediately beaten up because the British are afraid that such secret conversations will spark Indian nationalism. As the British inspector beats the prisoner, it is the Chinese body that receives the colonizer's abuse and bears the physical pain that we are told was meant to be inflicted on the Indian. The Chinese thus viscerally shares in the Indian's colonial experience, precisely in a moment when the two are conversely positioned as antagonists. In this way, Twin Souls instigates a radical reordering of the colonial power dynamics in Shanghai. Instead of positioning the Indian policeman and the Chinese citizen as antagonists on opposite sides of the colonizer-colonized divide, here we see the Chinese prisoner explicitly verbalizing a position of sameness with the colonized Indian. He says, "We have lost our nation. We are compatriots." For a moment, the invisible internal twinning of the Chinese and Indian souls becomes public and external, mirrored in the momentary oneness between the Chinese prisoner and his Indian prison guard. Twin Souls thus epitomizes the contradictory poles of literary friction, an antagonistic clash that in fact activates a fraught intimacy, an intimacy that makes possible new understandings of China's colonial condition. Twin Soul suggests that it is only by sharing intimately in India's experience of being colonized by the British that China can ultimately resist and protest against colonization. I'll now turn to my second example. During the early decades of the 20th century, and particularly in the wake of the May 4th protests of 1919, the Chinese literary sphere was plunged into debates over how literature could best shape a strong, modern, autonomous Chinese nation. Literature of semi-colonial China is often thought of as largely peripheral to these May 4th debates, or only relevant in terms of depicting Shanghai's fragmentary encounter with the West and the modernist literary practices of this urban encounter. Beyond Shanghai's modernism, texts of the Indian policeman show how this Indian figure provided a literary vehicle for the lived experience of China's colonial enclaves to enter into and reshape May 4th debates, which otherwise tended to be limited to elite literary circles. A 1927 short story by a young student in Shanghai and published in a student's magazine is entitled Hong Tou Asan. The phrase Hong Tou Asan was commonly used to refer to the Indian policeman, with Hong Tou meaning red head, referring to the turbans the policemen often wore as part of their uniforms. The story is written in the first person from the perspective of the Indian policeman and opens with the policeman's lament. Ever since he has arrived in China, all he hears are the sounds of people mocking him. He senses hatred from the rickshaw pullers and the pedestrians when they shout Hong Tou Asan at him, but struggles to understand what these four characters mean. One day, following an unpleasant incident with a rickshaw rider who yells, "Get lost, Hong Tou Asan," our policeman has an epiphany. He cries out, "I understand now, you hateful Chinese, I understand now. You condemn me as a Wang Guanwu, colonized slave. But you shouldn't get too complacent. Soon you too will become a Hong Tou Asan." By depicting a first-person narrator in a foreign land who is plagued with a crisis of nationality, the story explicitly alludes to the archetype of the May 4th anti-hero, a literary figure perhaps best exemplified by the famous writer Yu Dafu in his canonical 1921 story Chen Lun, Sinking. In Sinking, we see an unnamed Chinese protagonist in Japan tormented by his own nation's impotence and weakness that he seems to take on and embody. In one scene in Sinking, in a moment strikingly resonant with the one from Hong Tou Asan that I just cited, Yu Dafu's protagonist laments, "The Japanese look down upon the Chinese just as we look down upon pigs and dogs. The Japanese all call us Shinajin, Chinamen. These three characters are more derogatory than knave in Chinese." Just as Yu Dafu's protagonist struggles to overcome the weakness he attributes to China and to grow stronger, so does our Indian policeman yearn to overcome his nation's colonization. Melodramatically grieving his weak nation, the policeman cries, "My nation has been conquered and extinguished. Ah, motherland, why don't you fight back? Because of your cowardice, your people are everywhere mistreated by others." Similarly, Yu Dafu's protagonist cries, "You coward fellow, you are too coward. Why did I come to Japan? Since you have come, is it a wonder that the Japanese treat you with contempt? China, oh my China, why don't you grow rich and strong? I cannot bear your shame and silence any longer." Hong Tou Asan ends with the policeman weeping at the edge of Shanghai's Huangpu River, the channel by which the policeman would travel from India to China via ship. The policeman sighs, "Ah, motherland, my vast yet weak and cowardly motherland, from today onwards I forsake you. I wish you all, my compatriots, oh how I wish one day soon you could all wash away from your heads these three words, Wang Guanwu." The policeman's voice drowns out in the sounds of the river. Yu Dafu's story too ends with his protagonist poised on the shore of the sea that lies between China and Japan, apparently contemplating suicide. He exclaims, "Oh China, my China, you are the cause of my death. I wish you could become rich and strong soon. Many, many of your children are still suffering. I draw out these parallels between these two stories, one extremely famous and canonical, the other a minor story that's fallen out of the archives of Chinese literature, to show how the Indian policeman provided a literary vehicle through which China's colonial condition could enter into and influence the May 4th debates. Yu Dafu's story has been celebrated for its depiction of the trope of national humiliation, which became a central concern for many May 4th writers. This short story, Hong Tou Asan, depicts the Indian policeman's grief and shame for his motherland's weakness within the idiom of this May 4th discourse of national humiliation, explicitly echoing Yu Dafu's story down to its ambiguously suicidal ending. Hong Tou Asan inscribes the Indian policeman in May 4th discourse, and at the same time, the story frames the Indian's anguish of colonization in terms familiar to the Chinese reader and legible within popular literary conventions of the time. The Indian policeman and May 4th protagonist thus share in each other's national shame. While the story opens with the Indian as the object of Chinese hatred and a pathetic product of India's colonization, by the end, this Indian figure reveals himself as none other than the May 4th anti-hero. Scholarship on the Indian policeman in Chinese popular discourse has tended to see the Indian policeman singularly as an antagonist, the object of Chinese hatred and denunciations. Yet, as I have suggested in this talk, friction with the Indian policeman was also generative of new kinds of intimacies and new literary energies. In the novel Shuang Linghun, Twin Souls, we see the struggle between Indian invader and Chinese host as taking place on the most intimate of scales, within the very body. Unlike the popular understanding of the Indian policeman as a proxy colonizer in China, this level of intimacy helps reveal the larger structures of colonization that oppress both Chinese and Indian alike. And the short story Hong Tou Asan shows how, as a literary figure, the Indian policeman offered a way for China's semi-colonial experience to enter into and shape the May 4th debates. The short story offers the Indian policeman as legible within May 4th conventions of the time, and at the same time, it harnesses this Indian as a May 4th anti-hero in order to critique British colonization in China and even beyond China in India. These are only two examples of a wealth of Chinese poetry, short stories, and novels that engage with the figure of the Indian policeman. If you're interested in reading more, I would point you towards a chapter I recently published in an edited volume entitled Beyond Pan-Asianism. The chapter contains a much fuller discussion of the texts I've only very briefly introduced here, and it also contains a discussion of many other examples of such literatures. I want to end this talk by returning to the idea of friction, commonly used to denote tensions between nation states. I hope to have made a case today for reclaiming friction from this usage and reconceptualizing it as a form of transnational literary relation that addresses not only antagonistic clash between nation states, but also the forms of intimacy that underlie such a clash and the potential of this clash to issue new vectors of literary relation across national borders, even in moments of conflict. In August 2017, when Chinese and Indian militaries clashed in the disputed borderlands, Xinhua News put out an English language video framing the military conflict as an illegal and unprovoked invasion by India into Chinese territory. The video features a man dressed in a beard and turban, speaking in a caricature of an Indian accent. The video sparked outrage in India for its aggressive rhetoric and its racist depictions of Indians and unleashed a parallel wave of anti-China sentiment in India. What went unnoticed at the time was the allusion to the imagery of the Indian policeman, clearly visible here in this caricature of the Indian figure presented in the video. Conflating the very different circumstances of the colonial Indian policeman with the contemporary territorial disputes between China and India, the video aims to harness the memory of the Indian policeman as a despised figure in order to incite denunciations of India. But contrary to this video's suggestion, the Indian policeman was not uniformly despised. Importantly, he also evoked expressions of intimacy, among Chinese writers and readers who were able to see something of themselves and of China's condition in India's colonized status. And even expressions of hostility towards the Indian policeman never served singularly to incite hatred. They also played a productive and transformative role in the development of modern Chinese literature. Perhaps returning to the richness of Chinese literary engagement with the Indian policeman can help dismantle the parochialism of virulent nationalist rhetoric on display here and offer an alternative to such discourse currently on the rise again in both China and India alike. Thank you for watching. I would love to hear from you, and I welcome all suggestions, comments, questions. Please do feel free to email me at this email address.